This is Twitter plugin. The idea is taken from Tour de France. Mm-hmm. I'm not a cyclist, but I have created a small app that takes some data I scraped off their website. So we'll put on the yellow jersey, and I had in mind that I would have created a yellow jersey, but I forgot. So who am I? My name is Soren. I'm from Denmark, hence the strange letter in the O, which is called an Ø. I have been a Java developer since the year 2000, and I have been a Groovy and Grails developer since 2009. I am one of the OCI Grails team members, and I do mainly consultant work. I am also a GreatConf co-founder and organizer, and you may ask, what is GreatConf? GreatConf is another Groovy and Grails conference that was initiated in 2009 in Copenhagen, and we're still running every summer in the end of May, beginning of June. So if you want to see Copenhagen in June, that's a good opportunity. And I am a nerd by nature. And you know what? Recruiters love that sentence. I have that on my LinkedIn profile. I work for Optic Computing. Well, you know about them. They do Groovy and Grails project work, and we migrate plugins and write plugins, and we most definitely do the Grails core. And we are hiring Grails consultants.
How many hours a week do you work on the core versus writing billable?
For me, I work billable only.
Only, okay.
But well, if I have a chance, I can contribute to Grails core and. Yeah, often. Yes, that is smart. But a person like Graham is 100% time on core. But if there are hard to crack issues at a client, he will help out. So it's good to have a person like that that really knows the stack, and he does. And so does Jeff. Okay, the session agenda. I will go very briefly into why we want to use plugins, and I'll show you my basic application that I'm using to build on top of, so I have a frame to do the demo on. And then we'll do the first leg of the tour, which will be some of the installed plugins that's already in a Grails application when you run it the first time. And then we'll hit the mountains. I'll see if I can make 14 plugins in and one greater one, and it's mostly demo. And then Q&A, not so much, you just stop and ask me. And this is not a plugin how to write your own. Yes, that will take a whole session itself. So why plugins? Well, it does provide a multitude of extension points in your Grails application. You can hook into built steps, you can hook into the Spring context, you can define your own Spring beans, you can hook into artifact reloading, so that's mostly development, but it's still important that if some artifact change, you'll be able to reload whatever plugin you have if it requires you to interact with the newly created source files and stuff like that. It's a well-structured application, or it gives you well-structured applications, and it also provide reuse. It's often community-driven, the plugin ecosystem, and in most cases, there's no need to reinvent the wheel. Like, you could roll your own security. That's a bad idea. Yeah, been there, done that, never do it again. So where can you find the plugins? Well, you can go to plugins.grails.org. That's the Grails 3 plugins. Or you can go look in Bintray in the Grails. But there's no need to go there because the top one is a wrapper around the Bintray.
I don't think so.
For most parts. Yeah. And it's important to know that Grails 1 and Grails 2 plugins does not work in Grails 3. Because if you try to, it's just going to be a mess. So let's look at some plugins. If you want to check out the source, for the entire project. It's there. That's my fallback. If something goes wrong, I'll do a reset to a certain commit point and be on my way. But I hopefully will be able to do most of my talk without hitting a reset point in my repo. I will, however, to save time, copy and paste from a snippet document I have. I created a small Groovy script that would take my GitHub commit, make a diff between each, and make an ASCII doctor out of it. So that's that. So it's actually the diff you're looking at. So I'm going to sit down now, because standing up and coding is not super comfortable. And the first one I'm going to go into is DB Console. And you can say, well, actually, that's not really a plugin, but I felt it was appropriate to show its existence. And if my browser would be so nice to go out of full screen. Press escape. I did. Oh, there it is. Let's just run our application. And I got everything in IntelliJ IDEA because that's the easiest. That's the law, yes. And you can say that. So, and it's actually part of a multiple project because I have my slides in here and my snippets. So, but for this, I'll just run my demo to the plugin. And let's just run this as in debug mode in case we want to stop somewhere in the code and look deeper into it. And hopefully it won't take too long to start up. So meanwhile, while that starts, let's just look at what we have here. We have two scaffolded controllers, one for the team and one for the writer. And we have a team domain class. I have a name and a description. And that has many writers. The description is a text blob instead of just a varchar. And the writer is a little more extended, name, image, URL, weight, and when the writer was born. And how do I populate this? Well, I have a JSON document with that I scraped off the Tour de France Tour de France website in 2014 when I did this talk the first time. So I just reused that. I didn't have time to scrape this last year, so I figured this would do. And then of course I have a Bootstrap that will, if it ran on a database, a file-based database, it would not reload the data every time, but I'm running it in an in-memory, so it will simply jog through the JSON, parse it with a slurper, and create teams, and then add writers, and save everything. It's very, very basic. And there's nothing else to it. Standard Grails assets and an application that won't start. Let's just try and figure out why. That's not good. Let me just, maybe I need to do a clean. That could very well be. Let's just do this. Because I just checked out the almost base version of the project. So there, and then, and mostly, you know, when you run a Grails application, you don't have to restart for anything. But in our case, because we are adding dependencies, that will require us to restart on every step, unfortunately, because it has a tendency to take a little while. But we have to live with that. So let's just run it from here. Maybe we'll be lucky that it will use indexing. And we have to live with the small quirks of IntelliJ IDEA as well. So the first, that was the database console. Are you all familiar with the database console in Grails? Well, then we can just skip it. That saves us a step. It is a very cool thing. Okay, so the next, then I will, why is it running that? No, I hit the wrong.
You just use the console and then write Ruby code to access the database.
Yes. And you can look at what the tables Groovy created in the in-memory database. That's actually the coolest part of it, that is you have access to the in-memory database of H2. And the database console can actually be used to access any database as long as you have the driver is already in the project, right? And the URL you can copy from your config, and then you can connect to Oracle or Postgres or MySQL. So it's actually a very versatile little utility. So before I go into running the application, because that will actually just, I have to do one configuration change, because the first plugin I'll be discussing is the Grails scaffolding. Well, that is also, you've all created a small Grails app, so you know the scaffolding. So we'll just quickly skip, and we'll look at the code in a few seconds, but we'll skip looking at the code. So that's part of the standard web profile. So, because I want to get to the fun part. This is one of the fun parts, the Fields plugin. The Fields plugin is an attempt to keep your views dry. You could write a lot of boilerplate codes in views, but the Fields plugin will help you keep dry. And the Fields plugin was created by Rob Fletcher. He did a huge amount of work on that. And then a woman from Brazil did some additions to it, which she did really well. And Peter Ledbrook and Larry Hotari should also have kudos. Yes. So we'll do a demo of this. So let me just quickly. Just checking the views. Okay, for this could be a lot of code that I have to bring in. So I'm just gonna do this again to save some time. And while that boots up, I'll show you what I brought into the project. Because the way that the field plugin work is that you define a field in the template in your application. If you do an extract of a field, like let me just do generate all for demo team, then I get the views. The controller is already there, and generate all will not override your controller, so the controller keeps being what it was, but I'll bring in the views. So I have the views ready for you to look at. So we have a writer here. And perhaps eventually. Oh, it's because it's not that. Let's generate all. Oh, the fields, I wrote them by hand. Yeah. Tour writer. It's because I have another demo where it's called demo writer. So here we got the views. So the views. Let's just look at create. And there's one line in here that's interesting in our case, and that is the F all. That's one of the calls in the fields plugin. And what it does is it takes each property in the bean writer and creates an input field for it. And those input fields have a default value when you start out, but you can override pretty much everything in the fields. And if you look at the documentation for the field plugins, it's very well written. So one of the examples is that we have for a default field, we can define a wrapper. That's what we wrap around our input fields. Let's just open that and look at it real quick. So it contains information. Is it invalid? So if it has, it will create a hash error around the plugin or around the HTML it outputs. The field is the name of the field. The label is an internationalized translation of the field that it can look up in the bundle. And the way it does, it says the bean name, team, the property name, and then dot label. So making translations or another name for an input field is super simple. And then it renders the widget itself, which could be any input. And then if there's arrows, this is taken from the Twitter Bootstrap way of doing it, then it writes nicely the arrow below the field instead of a box above everything. You have to remove the box if you don't want both. But so that is an example of how you do a wrapping of the field. And then you have the string, then you have a widget itself. That's what will be wrapped when it meets a string type. It could also meet an integer type, then it would wrap an integer. Oh, I'm sorry, that's a little small. Let me just go here. So you can define a widget for any given type. So in this case, a widget for an integer, a widget for a string, a widget for a text area. And those will be different widgets. But the cool thing is, no matter where you use that widget, all over your GSPs, it will always be rendered the same way. So if you find out that your number input field should look different, you just change the wrapper, the widget, and it will change all over your application. Imagine you have a date input that uses the HITIS Grails date input. And then you decide, well, I want my dates to use a Twitter Bootstrap date input field. You have to change it once, and it will change all over your application. It's awesome. I'm not going to go any much deeper. Let's just quickly look at how the widget looks like. And there's a little bit of a quirk in this one, at least. No, not that. Tomorrow morning, I'll do a talk that's all about the fields plugins. I'm not going to go much deeper into it now. But as you can see here, the field rendering is just a text field. But adding this and going around to all your GSP pages and decide, now I have to add an extra class to my input widget, that would be a lot of work. And here you can do it one place and it's centralized. Okay, that was a field plugin. And it also does lists and the show page. It also has a field for show. Okay, the next plugin that's also built into our Grails application, now it's running, so we should be able to see it here. Or there. And we should just go and look at the page and see how it looks. So, we can see that we have these install plugins, and the ones that I'm going to go through here was the scaffolding. We just skipped that, basically. I will go through the caching plugin. It's actually a small but interesting plugin. And I will look at asset pipeline. And then we'll go begin to install plugins. So let's just quickly go to our writer. So one thing the field plugin does do is that it makes the application run a little bit slower if you disable the caching. But you have to disable the caching while you develop the plugin, or while you develop the templates. Otherwise, you'll have to restart the application all the time. So that's a little bit of a downside. But yeah, so the image is actually not stored in the database. That's just a URL in our, it's a string URL in the database. But it goes and look up that just by applying the fields plugin. So this is wrapped in if you go to Twitter Bootstrap and look at how they wrap input fields, that's how it looks. Okay, that was the first plugin. And then the caching plugin. So the easiest way to show the caching plugin is to go and just grab the code here, and I'll go through what is in there. Oops. Here. What this does is it brings in an additional controller and a service. So I have a demo controller here. That's just using an external service. So, and then it has a search, and then I have an evict and an evict all that will just call the external service. So the interesting part is that we can annotate our services with the caching annotation. So we have this external service here. So we can say, I want this value or this call to be cacheable. So, and I want to store it in an external data cache. So I have a slow query here. It takes 1,000 1 second. And the first time I call it, it will print that it did the query on the console. And the second time, it will just return in an instant. So let's see if the demo god likes me. It did recompile, so there's a chance. We go back to our Grails application here. And we have a demo controller. And of course, we're not really searching for anything, but just let write demo. No, it didn't wire in my Grails, my Spring Bean, unfortunately, so we'll just have to restart the application. That's one of the things that you experience once in a while. Grails is very good at, if you create a service, it will just reload it into the application context, and other times it forgets. So, and there's no way of knowing, so the reason I just rely on trial and error. But as you can see here, I can annotate my service and I can say, well, I want to store the query key as my key value, and the annotation will pick up the return value and store that as the value. And the next time I come in with the same query, it will just look at the cache, and it will return that value if it finds it. Otherwise, it will do this, the normal function call. And then I have an evict. So that could be, imagine, now it's just it's called evict entry, but imagine that you would save an entry in your database that has changed. Then it would be a good idea to evict that from the cache, so next time somebody comes and read it, it gets the new version. There's also a cache put, so if you wanted to, you could, on your save, you could cache put, then it would evict the element, and then it would reinstate the new saved value in the cache. So those four, and then of course we have an option to evict all entries in the cache in one go. The machine is a little bit slow in starting up. I'm not 100% sure why. For that, let's just, while we do this, go to this one. Oh, I don't even have a page for the cache plugin. That's embarrassing. It's mostly done by Jeff Scott Brown. It used, in early versions of Grails, it used to be a proxy. Now it's an ASC transform, so it doesn't create a proxy object anymore. It's the pure service, and you can in configuration if you really want. It has a proxy, you can. And then the default implementation is just an in-memory. So it doesn't evict anything. So if you use that in production, you will run out of memory. So you will have to choose an EH cache or a Redis cache or something else as a backing cache. And you can read all about that on the plugin page. And that's just an additional plugin that you install and config, and then it works. Okay, let's see if that works. We'll just resubmit the search. So the query took 1,110 milliseconds, and if I query again, it does it in 4. So, and we can also see that it has only written query for demo once. And if I click the evict and do the query again, we're back to 1 second. And if I query demo 2, of course I get something similar, and then when I query that one, it's almost in an instant. Nice little plugin. Especially if you have where you call REST backends, that's a lifesaver. If you know that the backend data is not changed by anybody but you, of course. But with the EH cache plugin, you can set timeouts, time to lives, and all that stuff. It can also do persistent caching, and EH cache can also do distributed caching if you have multiple servers, and there's lots of options there. Okay, so that was EH cache, or that was the caching plugin. So the next one could be the ACID pipeline plugin, but I've decided to do another plugin. That's an external plugin, and that's called the client dependency plugin. And this is the only non-Grails plugin. And let's just see here. It requires a few things in my built config file. I have this one is not running, so I'll just help it here. Probably be sad if this runs out of power. Okay, it will run out of power. That's too bad. It's not working. It's not charging, no. But I did what I could. So let's look at our... huh? Yes, it is. It's not the power strip, I think it's the USB cable. Okay, so what we need here is two things. We need up here in our built dependencies. No, not that. We need to define an additional plugin. Plugins, ID, com. Craig Burke, client dependencies, and we need to tell it what version we want. And that one is not a colon, like that. Craig Burke. Let's see if we refresh our dependencies. And then we need to tell it what dependencies we want. And that is done by adding a block in our built Gradle config. Client dependencies. And we say we want to use a Bower repository. So if you're used to working with the client libraries and getting things from the Bower command, like you can go in and type Bower search if you have Bower installed and find the library, and then you can go in here and say, I want a jQuery, and I want it in version 1.11 dot something, and I want Bootstrap, and I want that in version 3.3 point something. It will take the latest in that minor version. That was placed wrong, maybe. Yes. I have a feeling that it had skipped some of my code here. My beautiful script is tripping me out right now. Let me just make sure that it's working instead of fighting for it. There it is. Well, that should work, because that worked yesterday. This one. So the way that this actually quickly leads to the Acid Pipeline plugin. So I want to just go ahead and go through the few slides that I have for this, so we get to know who did it. The Acid Pipeline is easy for building. It has a variety of extensions modules, so you could use Less, Handlebar, CoffeeScript, Sass, and a lot of other cool pipeline products. So, and you come from the Rails world, so you're probably already familiar with. And it uses a lot of the same concepts, as far as I know. It does minification of your resources and zip file generation, and it can add caching headers and specific naming. So the name will have a hash on it, and whenever you change something in your one of your resources, it will change hash. So you won't get into a problem where it downloads the same cached version of your resource. So that's pretty neat. So when you deploy a new version of your application and something changes in your resources, the old one will no longer be in the client cache because it has a new name in what's required. So it rewrites the names in the GSP or in the HTML output. So it's a guy called Davis Estes that did the main work of this, and these are the other committers on the top. There's 31 more committers if you go to GitHub and look. I took the top four. And then the client dependencies. You define assets like Gradle dependencies, which is very nice. So you don't have to have your local, you don't have to download your assets and add them into your project. It's something you download instead, which I find much nicer than trying to remember to download the latest version and get everything working. And that's a guy called Craig Burke from Carnegie Mellon, I think he's works at, and I did a little bit to it as well, because one downside to it is if you sit there and experiment with resources that lives in GitHub, eventually you'll run out of requests for GitHub. But now you can authorize yourself, and then you get much more requests that you could do. So I added a GitHub authorization. So that was the client dependency. So what happened over here was that we got another new Gradle task called client dependencies. And if I click client install and we go over to this site here and look in our assets, I'm just going to zoom in here. Oh, maybe it will create a vendor, and I think this might be a remedy of something not cleaned out. But it will download our assets into this folder. Yes, this is a remedy of my previous run, so let me just quickly see if I can erase that. No, I didn't. And what I've done is it's still downloading in the asset folder, but I have removed, or I have added a git ignore for that folder. So I'm not going to get it into my repo. So let's just try and do client install again, and it will go to Bower and download your resources, and that's basically it. That's all it does. But you can add. I want to exclude this part of the library that I'm downloading, or I want to move these files to that folder, and so on. So you can actually control a lot about either in general. I want to ignore all readmes and all minified files because my asset pipeline will minify for me. So there's no need to include those in my vendor folder. So what it did was download everything into the vendor. So I have my Bootstrap here, and yeah, fonts and JS and jQuery. So it actually respects what's in the Bower JSON file. So that's the reason why the jQuery only has jQuery JS and nothing else. So now we have this, then we can go into our not image, but our JavaScript file. And here we have the normal. It will require, now it requires jQuery and Bootstrap. Before I did the asset pipeline, it would require just a jQuery that was in the Grails default installation. But I like it to be the latest, and I like it to be not really part of the things that I have in my GitHub repository. So that's the asset pipeline, and especially the client dependencies plugin. So the next plugin I'm going to show you is also in the asset pipeline line of plugin. It's Less. Are you familiar with Less? So the first thing we can do for that is go in again in our plugin descriptor here. No, not plugin descriptor, sorry. Our build file, and say, well, we depend on Bootstrap, but for Bootstrap now, we don't need fonts and we don't need the CSS because we're going to use the less instead. So we can just write exclude and then write fonts. And this is a normal glob and the CSS. And then we can say, I want Bootstrap less. I don't want that in a version 3.3x.x. And this one, I want to exclude. The reason I want to exclude the JS files, and I also want to exclude just everything in the root, is that the JS files are not in one file. They are 8 separate files, and I don't really want that. So that's why I include both Bootstrap and Bootstrap less. So first we go into client install. No, that was no what. Yeah, well, that's going to be a problem. So let's just stop this. It has a refresh. That will do a client clean and then a client install. So that way we get the vendor folder removed and added again. So now it's a less application, and we're going to require a few more steps because we're going to need the asset pipeline. It's both a Grails plugin, and it's also a Gradle plugin. So it's both the dependencies in the Grails world, and it's also a dependency in the Gradle world, because it's used both in the build part and in the runtime part. So up here, I'm going to add a dependency for the build part. From labs, plugins, less, asset pipeline, and then version 2.11.6. And then he has added a new type of dependency down here called asset. Assets. From apps, looking as asset pipeline 2.11.6, same version. And finally, we need down in our asset block here, we need to add an exclude. We don't want to compile each single file in the jQuery. Maybe that was because I was adding something while I did the refresh. Let's just try it again. We don't want to compile everything in the Bootstrap, but because less includes Bootstrap, so you only have to compile your top file, and then it will compile all the less for you, or it will include all the other less files for you. So it's important that you do not compile everything, otherwise it would be a mess. So excludes equals 2, and then and I have something that's not quite working. So I'll just do the other changes that I know I need to do. And one thing I need to do is I know that my application, the CSS, is not interesting anymore. What I need instead is a less, CSS.less, that I will be including instead. So to speed up things, I am going to reset here to make sure that everything works. That's just instead of typing. So now I have a application.css.less, and it can import either less files or CSS files. And the final result will be the ones combined into one file. And I can also apply variables to our less file. Let me see if I can get it to refresh my client dependencies now. And I'll show you why that's important, because you when you have a less or a Bootstrap, everything is the same color as the standard Bootstrap. So if you want to start changing colors, if you do it in the CSS file, that's hard to get right and to get everything looking at as you want it to. But doing it in a less file, they have a file called variables, and you can override those. So now, in our vendor folder here, we should have Bootstrap less files. And in here is a file called variables. And you open that and you see the colors that you have available, and that's in the top, so you have your branding colors here. And but you don't change this file You can either copy this file, or you can just copy the top part that does the definitions. And you can insert that in your application up here and override those, because the way that LESS works is that it reads in the whole definition, and if you do something below the first definition, that overwrites, and then when it's done reading all file, it does a compile. So that's very useful for styling your application. So, have any of you done Grails 2 applications? Okay, so you know about the Grails config location, where you can specify multiple config locations. That does not exist in Grails 3, right? I created a plugin for that. That's my next plugin. So it's very simple. Let's go back to our this one here and add a dependency for that. And that's again a compile. I'm just going to split it up in compile. So that's org 0.0. Let's refresh this. Yeah, if you use IntelliJ and you like shortcuts, there's a plugin for IntelliJ, has nothing to do with this otherwise, that will allow you to assign, it will monitor your usage of the mouse, and if you use the mouse clicks too many times, it will say, well, there's a shortcut for this. Or if there's not a shortcut for it, but you've used it like 5 times or 3 times, it will say, are you sure you don't want a shortcut for this because you're using it an awful lot? Okay, so now we have the external plugin available to us, and we can go to application.yaml. And let's just say we add, oh, that the by the way, the Grails plugin fields disable lookup cache. That's a thing to do when you develop field templates. So this one is equally simple. Grails plugin, no, Grails. And I have a single file in my home directory, and one of the things I did in the plugin was interpret the tilde as a home. So grails.external.groovy. So now when I run my application, it will actually go and read that configuration. And the only thing that's in the configuration is a print line. So I can see that it's red. Oh yeah, one more thing. It's not quite right what I'm saying. There is one more thing I need to configure, because this application there. This is the starting point of all Grails applications. It's a Spring Boot app that extends the Grails auto configuration. So that reads in the normal configuration and wire everything up in Grails. So the plugin that I created adds a trait, because you can also implement something called, yeah, well, we can look it in the trait. So implement external config. So let's just look at what's in this one, because we can actually look at the source code. Yep. I could also have implemented environmental aware on my application, and then I have done everything by hand. So this is just a helper. It's a small trait that helps you read external configs. So now when I run, it will go and look up external configurations. There's a few bugs in there. I know I'm aware of those. I just haven't had time to fix it. One of them is that it doesn't always override configuration values you have in your internal configurations, and it's supposed to. So I'm just going to need to find out why it's not loading configs in the right order. But that's hopefully a minor thing. And this is taking way longer than I anticipated. Well, we have half an hour, right? Okay, it's not that bad then. And as by the way, you can see here that client install is also called if the vendor folder is not there, so it will install automatically. So here you can see my config says loaded my external config. So this is it's a small thing, but it's very useful if you're trying to migrate your Grails 2 applications. And I also use it a little bit later when I get to the mail plugin. I don't really want anybody to see my Google credentials. So I have those in another external config that I load in. So that's actually the next plugin that we're going to look at. That's the mail plugin. And I'm going to do two plugins in one go. Because there's a mail plugin, and then there's a plugin called Greenmail. We want to be environmental friendly. So we don't want to send out mail on the internet, actually. It's much nicer if we could capture the mails we send in an internal SMTP server, and then we can look at them from within our application. So that's what the Greenmail server does. I will, however, just install both plugins and then only configure the mail plugin first. It's just to save a little bit of time. So compile, port Grails, mail 2.0.0, and that's still not released in a final version, and I believe that that's the same case for... Now we'll just take one plugin at a time, because otherwise we'll run, and then instead use the reset method here. So instead of coding, I will just bring in the code from the GitHub repository. Then there's a chance that we get all the way to the end instead, which is probably more important. Reset. So that will, again, find the external plugin, mail plugin. I forget to do this. So this just provides a small, nice DSL to send mail, and then it injects a send mail into controllers and services. So you send a mail by doing this. Like this. So you specify to from and subject and a text, or you could specify HTML, and then you can write HTML, or you can even use the Grails view renderer and render template. So look at the documentation, it has all you need to know. That's Jeff and Graham and Luke Daly and Craig Andrews, that's the main contributors for this plugin. And so now we have, just real quick close this and open it again. I have added a few things on my demo controller. I have a mail action now. That will take a mail command. The mail command is simply just two subject and texts, and a few constraints on the, so I'm not allowed to enter something that's not an email address into the email, and the subject cannot be empty, and neither can the text. And it renders a view with some, actually just simply uses the field plugin that I created previously. And what else? Not much. It calls, it creates the command object, and if the command object is valid, I call send mail with whatever's in the body of, or in the command object. And I only do this if it's a post. If it's a get, I'll just render the output here. So fairly simple. And the reason I clear the arrows here, just to tell you why, is because whenever Grails binds properties or params to the command object, it also does a validation. And when it's a get and there's no parameters on the request, it's not valid because everything is null, right? And we just said that nothing can be null. So we have an object with errors in it. But if I clear the errors before I send it out to the view, it doesn't show that there's errors in it anymore. So that's a neat little trick. So you can reuse the same action for both get and post. So let's see if we have a running application. I am fairly sure that we do not have the one that we just made. As I said, this is the downside of doing a demo with plugins, because we have to restart the server all the time. And my machine is a little slow. So maybe I should see if I can get this working. Probably be happy if it works. So it's gonna die in a few minutes, but if we're lucky, it will stay alive. Yep. So in a few seconds, this should be up and running. And now you can see it loaded my demo secret as well from. So now I have access to my mailbox, and I have and one thing I have in my real configuration YAML is you can specify for the Grails mail plugin who is the default recipient. So when you sit and test it, you can enter any email address you want to, but it will always send to whoever you specify in your config, which can be very handy. So now it's running. And we have this demo.mail. So we can write an email, just write my own. Test, very clever, and hopefully we have internet connection and eventually I'll receive an email here. But it's that easy to send an email. But as I said, it's not always the best way of sending email when you're testing. You don't want you don't want to send out emails all the time. And also, if you do a functional testing, you can actually interrogate the internal SMTP server on what emails it received to check if it received the right information. So when you send the mail with your either integration test or functional test, so say you test this interface, enter an email address and a subject and a text with JEP, and then click the send button. If you have the green mail configured, you can go in and read from that internal server, did it receive what I expected it to receive? That is also very clever. And does it have the right headers? Does it have, anything you want to know about that email is available. So that's one of the reasons that's one of the plugins that I really always highlight when I do this talk, because I think it's really important that you can easily get to that point where everything is easily testable. Yes, you would definitely do that. You will definitely do that. And that is done, let me see here. I don't understand why this file is not reloading. Either that or, I know why. Because you can have two configuration files. I have a YAML file, and I also have an application.groovy. That's a groovy way of configuring. And the reason why is that this one has this, let me just uncomment this. It has this part where it defines a map for properties for the, to configure the mail plugin. And that doesn't work very well in the YAML file. So that's why you can, that's a good reason to have both types of configs. So, but what I do here is I simply define my port as the green mail server setup test SMTP port. It also has a POP3 internal in green mail and a IMAP. So it has a lot more features than we use here, but this is just the main feature. And I've not tried the other ones, so I just spotted that they are there. So again, unfortunately, we have to restart the server. But while we do that, we can just be nice and look who has done this and why I think it's a good idea to use. It prevents spamming of your inbox. And that's often what you do when you test emails, is you send emails to yourself over and over and over again. And you fill up your email box and eventually you just run sour. And then it allows the integration tests of email, and it's very, as you can see in the config, it's one line. And what you would do if you have this and you want to prevent it from being configured in anything but your development environment, is that you would go in and say environments, development, and then you'll copy this block in here. And then it will only be available, and then you could make a production prod. Production, and then you would have the SMTP for whatever SMTP server you're using for that part. Very easy. Yeah. And did I actually receive that email? And so this plugin was done by a guy called Mike Hugo. And again, Luke Daly is working for Gradle now. He's back in Australia. He's an Aussie guy. Awesome, awesome personality. I've had him speaking at my conference a couple of times. It's really nice. So now we have a running application. Well, we actually don't want to reopen this. We can just send this mail again. And it said it sent the mail to me, but if I open the green mail, I actually, by the way, received the email here from demo one. I open the green mail controller and list, and now I have the list of received emails, and the latest one is always on top. So I can show it, and it's not very pretty, but it works. It works to the extent that you can see if you got it right. I don't know if I turn off the screen on this one, it might last a little longer. So that's the green mail plugin. We could also have utilized SendGrid. There's also a plugin for SendGrid. And one of the things I like about the SendGrid plugin is that it's a good if you don't have access to an SMTP server. And SendGrid can act either as an SMTP server, and you can configure the mail plugin for that, or you can send by their API. And the cool thing is the API looks pretty much like the mail send mail API. The only difference is that it doesn't inject send mail directly into your controller and services. You have to include the SendGrid service. But then you can combine both. They're not excluding each other. So, and another thing is that it uses the version 2 API of SendGrid. So it does not use an API token, but username password. But it's actually, you can just use the SendGrid to have a Java library directly. And it's really, really easy to wire up as a Spring Bean. And then you don't need the plugin. But I'm not going to go through that. But this plugin was created by these people, or by Anthony Jones. And I know Roberto has added something to it. But an upgrade to the latest API would probably be a good idea. And the demo, I'm just going to show you the code. I'm not going to try and send email with it. So let's just, actually, we can just, I'll show you the code when we include the next step here. That's a plugin. You know, you can have enums as database entries. So it will actually store the enum value in a database table. And when you retrieve it, it will go back to being an enum instead of a string. So that will lock down values that you can select in the select box. And that's very nice. And if you add that, let's just do that for our I'm just going to go back to my snippets here. So that is a plugin. It's actually a plugin that I created myself. So what it does is a standard way to implement i18n on enums. And so it has a consistent translation throughout the application, which is can be an advantage. So that's one that I created. And I come from Denmark, so translation is more relevant there maybe. But on the other hand, I'll show you why it could be relevant to you too. Let's start by looking at our domain class and take the writer here. And I think I'm just going to import the code and tell you what it does, because there's a little more. We have 15 minutes and we're not quite there yet. Okay, so it will add another property to my writer. Now he has a speciality. That could be, he could be a mountain climber, or he could be a sprinter, or he could be an all-arounder. So let's look at the speciality enum here. That's the three: sprinter, mountain, and all-around. And it implements the I18N enum trait. And right now it's red because I didn't refresh the dependencies. That's not what I wanted to do. Like that. And meanwhile, I'll just go in to the I18N here and messages and show you what I added here. Right now I have added a speciality mountain label. So it will be a mountain rider, right? That's one of the things you can do. So it will take the enum value and label and use that in the wherever it's presented in the dropdown. And also in the configuration, in the application.yaml, I have added a few things. I tell it that in my, when it looks up in the bundle, it will postfix the enum class dot the enum value, and then it will postfix it with label. And it will use the short name for the enum class, so it doesn't use the package also. And then the translation, if it does not find a translation in the bundle, it will do an all caps, so it will remove the if there's any underscores, it will remove the underscores, and then it will make all lower caps, and then capitalize each letter, and so it actually looks nice in the UI. So it saves a lot of time. If you use enums for various things, you can save yourself some time by using a plugin like this. It's still going to be used to, this is only for the front end. And the reason why I created it, let me just show you what it actually does. Now that it's part of, hopefully. Okay, the thing is, you can implement an interface called message source resolvable. That will tell the runtime that for this one you have implemented get code, get args, and get default message. And the implementation for an enum would be the same over and over and over again. So I figured this has to be done easier. So I implemented in Grails 2, it was an AST transform, but in Grails 3, we could do it as a as an enum. Something is wrong here. Let me just see what happened. That's why I didn't recognize it. So this is actually just a standard implementation of an interface. And with traits, you can, that's a cool part of Groovy. You can make functionality that's included as actual code, instant code. Because you also have default methods on interfaces in Java 8, but that can only be static methods. So that doesn't really give you any help, right? Now, it would be nice if it would work. What is this flashing for here? Stack Overflow. Yes, that's pretty much what I'm asking you for. Oh, there it is. Now it recognized it. So this actually just have get codes and get arguments for an enum that will always be the an empty array, and then look at the if I want uppercase, lowercase, capitalized, and all caps. So it's pretty basic, right? But it really gets the job done, and then it can read the config, and it also has, it's also possible to use it as an annotation on your enums instead of an implementation, and then you can config each enum separately. So you can add configuration values to, if you use it as an ASC transformation instead. So that's, but that can be read in the documentation. So, but what it does is when we run our application here, we can see that the writer now has an additional field, and that's a dropdown with the translation that is in my bundle. And while that starts up, let's just quickly move forward to the next plugin called the console plugin. You're all familiar with the Groovy console. And you can also start a Grail console. You can run Grails with console, and then it will boot up the application just until the web layer, and then it will show a Groovy console instead. That's fairly clever. Then you can interact with the database and services and stuff like that, but you cannot run the UI. So what the console plugin does, it actually starts the application to its full extent, and then has a controller where you can go in, and then you get a web console where you can code Groovy, and then you can execute Groovy against your running application. So it's a keyhole into your application. So it's great for inspection and debugging, but it also comes with a great responsibility, right?
How's that secured?
I don't remember if I read it in the config, but I bet the guy that made it probably made it so that it only runs in development environment. But I would go check the documentation thoroughly. But it could be useful in a production environment if it's protected well, right? Yeah. And one thing I could see it used for is that you have access to the logger, so you can go in and change log levels in runtime, right? That's a good thing. And you don't want to make a full UI for changing log levels. You could do that, but that's also a bit cumbersome, right? So these are the guys that should have kudos. Let's just inspect the application with Yes, so that's what I would expect it from guys that did this, but yeah. So we have this writer thing. Let's just finish off the I18N thing. Let's just go directly edit and then one. He doesn't have a speciality right now, but you can see that it nicely removed the underscore and capitalized the name of on this one. And this one has a mountain rider because that came from the translation bundle. And if the interface was running in Danish, I could have had a translation for all three of them that would fit with my language, right? So it's an easy way, and I didn't change anything UI-wise here. I didn't go in and create a field for the field plugin or anything. It's simply out of the box that Grails does this. So, excuse me? Yes. What is it in the robots? See a need, cover a need, or something like that. It's a little bit different, but it's a nice saying. So I have three plugins left, and we have 5 minutes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to skip to the very last one, so I don't have to restart the server every time. But I will go through them all. So we can go through the plugins that we have, and then we can look at the code. So it's the console, and the Swartz, and the Spring Security. So of course it has added some dependencies, pretty much gives itself, Swartz and Spring Security, and the console is it's not a compile dependency, it's a console dependency. Yes, and let's do a run of that. And while that starts up, we can just look at who did it. So the Swartz plugin is actually pretty new. You will probably, no, not Swartz, Swatch. So it's a plugin that wraps the Quartz library. And there is another Quartz plugin, but I just felt it would be nice to give these guys some credit. It's a very nice wrapper to the Quartz Java library, and it supports clustering, the plugin did as well. You get very fine-grained control over how to configure your jobs, and it is a replacement for the other Quartz plugin. So it's very easy to create a job. You just use it. It introduces a new command in your Grails command line called create jobs or create job, and you will create a job like that. It has a cool logo. And it's guys from Agile Orbit that has created this plugin. And then finally, we have a Spring Secure Core plugin that most of you are probably familiar with, right? Have you seen that before?
I haven't.
Okay. So it's probably, I dare to say, it's the most important plugin in the Grails ecosystem. It's for security, but it's really, really well written, and it really, when you install it, it really locks your application down to no access at all, and that's very important because some of the old implementations, some of the old implementations of Spring Security plugin, you had to remember to secure every controller that you implemented. And that could leave any very important controller open. But this one, he really locked down everything. And then you can start opening up things. And that's much better. And it's very well documented. And it's fairly easy to use. Which is three important things in my mind. And it's well tested. The fourth thing. It's highly configurable. The config you can do on this thing is amazing. Every entry point into it can be configured and replaced. That's also why there's an extended list of sub plugins, because it allows him to extend the plugin in various places. And it has very fine-grained access control. And it has this 18 sub project. So that's pretty amazing. Yeah. So, and it's also very easy to set up. It's like, do a quick start, tell it what package you want your thing in, and what the user and role domain classes should be, and you're good to go.
Then you often mix this one with the UI one.
I have not tried the UI one, but I bet it works pretty well. And the major contributor to this is Bert Beckwith. He has done a ton of work on this, and all the sub-projects also. So let's see if our application is running. But before we do that, well, we can see that it is running because it already triggered my job. And let's look at the job first. No, actually, let's look at the console first, because that was the first one. So console. And hope I added that to the config for admin. Nope, denied. So we need a small adjustment to our config. So the config has this static rules concept. So right now it doesn't permit console access, so we'll just duplicate a line here and say console, and then everything in there just to make sure. And we could do a permit all, but that ugh. So we'll just write role admin like that. And unfortunately we have to restart that, but while we restart that, we can just make the tour to our service that did the output from Swatch. So unlike the old Quartz plugin, the Quartz plugin would make a new folder called jobs. So it was a new artifact type. For this one, it's not a new artifact type. It's simply a type that extends, implements a Swatch job. And presumably a Swatch job is not an interface, it's presumably a trait. So it adds functionality. So it has an execute. That's what executes a job. And that can be transactional or it cannot be transactional. If you don't annotate it with transactional, it will not be. So it doesn't require it to run a transaction. And it gets the job context, so you can actually get some more information on what the job execution engine provides of information. Like, what trigger did it? Was it a manual triggering? Was it automatic? Did somebody skip a trigger because of the previous invocation was not done? And stuff like that. That's all available in that job execution context. And then you build the trigger itself. And it has an internal list of triggers, and it has a factory to say, well, for my trigger here, it does intervals of 5 seconds, and it repeats 12 times, and then it stops. So you can actually see when it runs now, it will trigger the job 12 times, and then it will never run again. And you can add hundreds of different triggers to the same job. And you can probably do that programmatically as well. So you can have a UI. My best bet will be that there will be a UI eventually to control jobs that you can just install next to this plugin. So let's see if we are more lucky this time that we have access to our console. Now I'll be asked to log in again. And while it has the remember me checkbox, you have to make it enable in the, it has to be in the config as well. So now we have access to our entire Grails stack from within our browser. So what could be fun? System exit, that's kind of boring, right? But let's remember we have this demo service somewhere. Maybe. External service, that's what it's called. And here we have the slow query. Let's just try and see if we can say CTX, that's the context, and external service, that's our service name, and then slow query something. And we would expect it to take about a second or so. Plus it took some time to find the mean. And the next time it's pretty fast because it's cached. So we could also here get access to cache service. I think that's... If I just write CTX cache service, it says null. That's because that's not the name of it. Then I couldn't remember the name of it, but we could probably find that in the... And then we could call, and if we could get hold of the cache service, we could call it evict all on that. So clear all caches in the entire system by calling a method on the cache service if we knew exactly what it was named. That's just a matter of memory. Well, here you have access to all the beans defined in the Grails application, everything. You have access to config, you have access to session, you can even get access to the print stream that for the console, you can probably replace it with something else if you want to. It's really, really cool. And it also have options to save things. If you have this running on a server, you can save things to the application Tomcat directory so you can receive previous files that you already had. You can also include files that in your application for scripts that you know that you want to run from the console so you don't have to write everything by hand. Up here is save as, and you have a folder. There's just nothing in here yet, but it's really cool. And I think it's something that you could consider having in your production environment as long as you lock it down real hard. Yeah. And why roll your own when you have this? And what was the final one? Well, Spring Security. What it did for me when I ran the... It created a role. So that's just an authority. It's one table with one column plus the columns that... and then... username, password, and some flags for enabled, expired, locked, and then you actually have a way to get a user's authority, but because you can have a huge user base, when Bert did this, he wanted to make sure that you didn't have a one-to-many relationship in the database, you had it only in the model. That's why you have this. Role user find all by user this. So you have a table, but it doesn't have has many. It's just a table with two references to the role and the user, but there's no one to many and one-to-many, so it's not a, it's because otherwise it would be a many-to-many that could be really, you risk loading a lot of information into memory. But with this structure, you do not risk that. So in the user, you can go and say, find all by user, and then role, then you get a list of roles. And also he happens to make sure that when you enter the password into the domain, and when you save, when you get the password from your UI and start saving it, it will encrypt it. So you don't have to worry about the encryption. And that happens through the security service. So it uses the same hash, and you can replace the Spring Security encoding algorithm, so you can salt a password. Why not just hash it here? It hashes it. It hashes it, but it uses Spring Security Service to do it. And the clever part about that is that you as a developer can decide how advanced your hashing should be, because it uses the same hashing algorithm when it validates the password coming in through a login. So that could, for example, be salting the user with its own username, or it could be salting it with a random thing that is stored in a database, or what have you. It opens up a multitude of options here. So it's, as I said previously, it's really, really well written. And then the way you secure your controllers is super simple. Well, not the Raider. This one is the only one I demo controller. I think it's the only one I've secured. You simply secure it by writing secure it, and then you tell it what roles have access. And you could write multiple roles here, but if you have a role, he will also be user, and then you can make a role hierarchy in your config. So you say role admin is greater than role user. So when the the role is checked, it will go into the role hierarchy and check that what roles you override. But if you were only in our application here, if I'm role admin, no, if I'm role user, I'm not role admin right now. So when we go back here to the front of our application, and by chance, it should have demo control. I'm not authorized because my admin role right now does not override my user, but
you can make that hierarchy
in the config, yes. Which is very nice compared to having to do it all over, and then you find out that yes, I can. I need to find it because I don't have it. But it's let's just that's I think that's the easiest way to find it. Oh, that's Spring Security, so you need. I'm just going to add Grails as a keyword, and I think I'll get, there it is. It's the same for the previous, so you simply just write this. Let me just enhance that. So you say role hierarchy, and then you make a multi-line string, and you say role super admin is better than role finance admin, and role finance admin is greater than role admin, and so forth and so on. And that means that super admin is also greater than role admin. So that it knows that if you're greater than one and the next one is greater than another one, the first one is greater than. So it's, yes, it's very simple. So, yeah. And for the annotation here, it can either be controller level or action level, or both. You can have role user here, and you can say, well, for my, let's just say, my SendGrid, I want this to be role admin. And for my search, well, I'm actually good with permit all. So now my controller in general has to be role user, and my search is open for everybody, and my SendGrid was open to admin. Very configurable. I think that's it. Let me just finish my slideshow. Not much left there, but a summary. Lots of already coded functionality. I think that's a big takeaway. And it's often well tested. And there's often a large community helping you out. And what can you do? Well, I think that feature requests and bug reports are important. Say thanks. Right people that created a plugin. That was a good plugin, thank you. It's nice to get recognition. And eventually you start writing you and submitting your own plugins. Because if you write something that's worthy of a plugin, probably somebody else need it. That's how I got the i18n enum plugin. I was getting tired of writing extends or implements message source resolvable and implement those three interfaces. So I decided, and since an enum, you cannot extend it, you can only implement interfaces on it. Well, that was the only way I had to do it.
What's your barometer for using a plugin? Let's see a pull request in the last year, 2 years? Or
depends. Does it work? If it works and there's no bugs in it that you found, there's no bugs in it for the things that you need it for, I would say, why not use it? And if you bump into something and the original contributor has gone away for some reason, moved on to other work, and you can see, well, that's actually pretty easy fix. Either do a pull request and hope that they merge it in, or ask them if they have decided not to work on this anymore and say, can I take over? And it there's nobody in the community that expect you to continue working on a plugin. But for the duration that you do it, it's very much appreciated. So, and if I don't do anything on my external config plugin or my i18n plugin for years, well, somebody else can. And if somebody fixes a bug and submit a pull request and I don't have time to do anything but merge that in, well, that's fine. So, it is an ecosystem that requires participation by the community. No doubt about that. But it's not that complicated. So, thank you. And feel free to contact me. That's my information. I hope you found it useful. And by the way, I forgot to say this in the last talk. And nobody, not many people know this, but there's actually a rating system in this. So if you click on this one, you can go in and evaluate it. And then I get at least three evaluations, right?
Yeah.
Oh, screen recording.